Hello students, in this video we will be seeing block cipher principles, differential and linear cryptanalysis, block cipher design principles, block cipher modes of operation from unit 2. First we will see about block cipher. Block cipher is a deterministic algorithm operating on fixed length group of bits called as blocks. It uses an unvarying transformation, that is, it uses a symmetric key. Symmetric key is nothing but the same key which is used in either ends, that is, during encryption as well as decryption. They are specified elementary components in the design of many cryptographic protocols and are widely used to implement the encryption of large amount of data, including data exchange protocols. Modern block ciphers are widely used to provide encryption of quantities of information and cryptographic checksum to ensure the contents we have not been altered. It provides secrecy and authentication services. It mainly focuses on data encryption standard. It is used to illustrate block cipher design principles. We continue to use block ciphers because they are comparatively fast and because we know a fair amount of about how to design them. We will use the widely known DES algorithm to illustrate some key block cipher design principles. The picture shown here explains about the working of modern block ciphers. N-bit plain text is given as an input to the encryption block and which produces N-bit ciphertext. Similarly, in the decryption side, it uses the same procedure. Now we will see the important parameter, the difference between block cipher and stream cipher. Though both look similar, there are few minute differences are there. In block ciphers, processes messages in blocks, each of which is then encrypted or decrypted. It is like a substitution on very big characters. It uses 64 bits or even more. Whereas in stream ciphers, it processes messages a bit or a byte at a time when encryption or decryption is in the process. Many current ciphers are using this concept called as block ciphers, and it is used widely also. Most symmetric block encryption algorithms in current use are based on the structure referred to as a freestyle block cipher. A block cipher operates on a plain text of blocks of n bits to produce ciphertext blocks of n bits. An arbitrary reversible substitution cipher for a large block size is not practical. However, from an implementation and performance point of view, for an n-bit general substitution block cipher, the size of the key is n into 2 power n. For a 64-bit block, which is desirable length of thwart statistical attacks, the key size is 64 into 2 power 64, which is equal to 2 power 70, which is equal to 10 power 21 bits. In considering these difficulties, Freestyle points out that what is needed is an approximation to the ideal block cipher system for a large N, built up out of components that are easily realizable. Freestyle refers to an N-bit general substitution as an ideal block cipher because it allows for the maximum number of possible encryption mappings from the plain text to the ciphertext block. A 4-bit input produces one of 16 possible input states, which is mapped by the substitution cipher into unique one of 16 possible output states, each of which is represented by the 4-bit ciphertext bits. The encryption and decryption mappings can be defined by the tabulation. It illustrates a tiny 4-bit substitution to show that each possible input can be arbitrarily mapped to any output, which is why its complexity grows so rapidly. Claude Shannon introduced the idea of substitution permutation networks in 1949 paper. Critically, it was the technique of layering groups of S boxes separated by a large P boxes to form the SP network, a complex form of a product cipher. He also introduced the ideas of confusion and diffusion, notationally provided by S boxes and P boxes. The cipher needs to be completely obscure or completely unclear with the statistical properties of the original message or the plain text message. More practically, Shannon suggested combining S and P elements to obtain diffusion and confusion. Normally, diffusion means which dissipates statistical structure of plain text over bulk of ciphertext. Whereas confusion means makes relationship between ciphertext and key as complex as possible. Now we will see the diffusion and confusion with the help of this picture. Diffusion means that if we change a single bit of a plain text, then half of the bits in the ciphertext should get changed. And similarly, if we change one bit of the ciphertext, then approximately one half of the plain text bits should get changed. Confusion means that each binary digit or bit of the ciphertext should depend on several parts of the key, obscuring the connections between the two. Horst Feistel, working at IBM Thomson's J. Watson Research Labs, devised a suitable invertible cipher structure in early 70s. One of the Feistel's main contributions was the invention of suitable structure which adapted Shannon's SP network in easily inverted structure. It partitions input blocks into two halves. We can see this one in the picture. It partitions the input blocks into two halves, which are processed through multiple rounds, which performs a substitution on left-hand half based on round function of right half and subkey, and then have permutation swapping halves. We can see in the animation like the original message is added with the key and it is sent to the final block. To be more clear, the classical Feistel cipher structure with the data splits into two halves, processed through a number of rounds which perform a substitution on left half using output of round function on the right half and key, and a permutation which swaps halves as listed above. The exact realization of Feistel network depends on the choice of the following parameters and design features. Block size. Increasing the block size improves the security, but it will slow the cipher. Second parameter is key size. Increasing the size improves the security, which makes exhaustive key searching harder but may slower the cipher. Number of rounds. Increasing the number of rounds improves the security, but again it will slower the cipher. Subkey generation algorithms. Greater complexity can make analysis harder, but it will again slower the cipher. Round function. Greater complexity can make analysis harder, but again slower the cipher. Both subkey generation and round function are the same. Next parameter is fast software encryption or decryption. More recent concern for practical use. Ease of analysis. For easier and validation, Feistel cipher decryption is the reverse of the encryption process. The rules are as follows. Use the ciphertext as input to the algorithm, but use the subkeys ki in reverse order. That is, use the kn in the first round and kn-1 in the second round, and so on until k1 is used in the last round. This is the nice feature because it means we need not implement two different algorithms, one for the encryption and one for the decryption. Behem and Shamir show differential cryptanalysis can be successfully used to cryptanalyze the DES with an effort on the order of 2^47 encryptions requiring 2^47 chosen plaintext. They also demonstrated this form of attack on a variety of encryption algorithms and their hash functions. Differential cryptanalysis was known to be IBM DES design team as early as 1974, and influenced the design of S-boxes and the permutation P to improve the resistance to it. Compare DES security with the cryptanalysis of an 8-round Lucifer algorithm, which requires only 256 chosen plaintext, versus an attack on an 8-round version of DES requires 2^14 chosen plaintext. Statistical attack against Feistel cipher is very complex. It uses a cipher structure which is not used previously. The design of SP networks has output functions F influenced by both input and output key. Hence, we cannot trace values back through cipher without knowing the value of the key. Differential cryptanalysis compares two related pairs of encryptions. attack is known as differential cryptanalysis because the analysis compares differences between two related encryptions and the looks for a known difference in leading to a known difference out with some probability. If a number of such differences are determined, it is feasible to determine the subkey used in the function f. This equation shown here explains how this removes the influence of the key and hence enabling the analysis. This figure illustrates the propagation of differences through three rounds of DES. The probabilities shown on the right refers to the probability that a given set of intermediate differences will appear as a function of the input differences. Overall, after three rounds, the probability that the output differences is shown is equal to 0.25 into 1 into 0.25, which is equal to 0.0625. Since the output difference is same as the input, this three round pattern can be iterated over a larger number of rounds with the probabilities multiplying to the successively smaller. Most recent development is linear cryptanalysis. This attack is based on finding linear approximations to describe the transformations performed in DES. This method can find DES key given 2 power 43 known plaintext as compared to 2 power 47 chosen plaintext for differential cryptanalysis. Although this is a minor improvement because it may be easier to acquire known plaintext rather than chosen plaintext, it still leaves linear cryptanalysis infeasible as an attack on DES. We will see the differences between linear cryptanalysis and differential cryptanalysis. Linear cryptanalysis uses mass for input and output, whereas differential cryptanalysis uses XOR for input and output. Linear uses linear probability, whereas differential uses differential probability. Linear cryptanalysis uses linear characteristics functions with linear hull. Differential cryptanalysis uses differential characteristic with the differential hull. Linear characteristic probability is used in this linear cryptanalysis, whereas differential characteristic probability is used in differential cryptanalysis. The expected linear characteristic probability is being used in linear cryptanalysis, whereas expected differential characteristic probability is used in differential cryptanalysis. So we can see that linear being used in linear cryptanalysis and differential is used in differential cryptanalysis. The maximum average linear hull probability is used in linear cryptanalysis. Maximum expected differential probability is used in differential cryptanalysis. The cryptographic strength of a Feistel cipher derives from three aspects of the design, that is, the number of rounds, function, and the key schedule algorithm. The greater the number of rounds, the more difficult it is to perform cryptanalysis, even for a relatively weak f. F means function here. The function f provides the elements of confusion in a Feistel cipher and wants it to be difficult and unscramble the substitution performed by f. One obvious criterion is that f be nonlinear. One of the most intense areas of research in this field of symmetric block cipher is that of S-box design. Would like any change to the input vector to an S-box to result in random looking changes to the output. The final area of block cipher design is a key schedule algorithm. With any Feistel block cipher, the key schedule used to generate a subkey for each round. Fine, we have come to the end of this topic. We'll see the next topic in the next video. Thank you.